Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome. I'm the Dean of the Humphrey School, Eric Schwartz, and it's my real pleasure to welcome you all here this evening. I guess it is this evening. It's after 5, so it's this evening. We are delighted to welcome Jim Zogby. Dr. Zogby is the founder and president of the Arab American Institute, which engages in policy research and advocacy involving the Arab American community. He is also the managing director of Zogby Research Services. He has a long record of involvement in key policy issues involving the United States and the Arab world. He most recently served on the Democratic Party Presidential Platform Drafting Committee, was deeply involved in negotiation on platform positions relating to a Middle East peace. He appears frequently in the media and is currently a chair of the Editorial Advisory Committee of Sky News Arabia, and he has for many years written a weekly column appearing in 14 Arab and South Asian countries. The way we'll proceed this evening, Dr. Zogby will offer some introductory remarks, and then I won't invite because you will just come to join Dr. Zogby. Professor Raghi Assad of the Humphrey School of Public Affairs. Professor Assad is the chair of our global policy area. He runs our Masters of Development Practice program does a whole lot of other things here at the Humphrey School, and he will also be joined by Mary Curtin, a former U.S. diplomat who is our diplomat in residence here at the Humphrey School, our global policy coordinator. They will begin and have a conversation, and then I think they will take questions from the audience. Please join me in welcoming Dr. James Zogby.
Thank you, Eric. Ooh. Thank you very much. I spoke this during lunchtime about some of the issues we'll talk about this evening, and made mention of the fact that I had served on the U.S. Commission on International Religious Freedom with Eric for 3 years, and he made the experience bearable. He is very principled and very thoughtful fighter for what is right and what is just, and I appreciated the opportunity to be with him. It was something we talked about when I was on the commission, but Eric left. I'm still there fighting the fight, and I am pleased to have the opportunity to accept the invitation to come and join you. I want to talk about where we are in the Middle East because it is an issue that we don't talk about in presidential politics, and yet every U.S. president has his and very possibly her term, I should say very probably her term, defined by their experience in the Middle East. From the time of, at least from Jimmy Carter on, presidents have been judged successful or failures by what has unfolded in the Middle East and their ability or inability to deal with the consequences of what was taking place in that region. Most often it's failure. And it's failure because, frankly, we have never had a clue about how to deal with the dynamics in that region. I'd go further and say that if you think about it, since the end of Vietnam, and even before the Iraq War, the period of time between Vietnam and the Gulf War, we spent more money, we sent more troops, we lost more lives, even before the Iraq War. Fought more battles, sent more weapons to countries in the region, have more at stake economically and politically, and have expended more political and diplomatic capital in that region than anywhere in the world. And so it's bizarre to me that we never have a substantive debate in presidential years about the person who will lead us, nor do we have a substantive debate in congressional elections or Senate elections. It's assumed this issue is off the table, we're not going to talk about it, because there's a consensus that we will do as we have done, which is basically allow the region to continue to drift into where it is today. To a great extent, the crisis, the unique set of circumstances that we're in today predate the Obama administration and actually are the result of major blunders committed during the Bush administration. I call it the house that George built. Two failed wars that had the result of literally destroying American credibility in the region and in the broader region. When we poll in the Arab world and in Europe, we would note that America's favorable ratings had declined in Egypt and in Jordan and in countries that were allied with us. But what we don't note all the time is that our numbers equally declined in Italy and in Spain and in France. During the Bush years, we plummeted into the 20% favorable range throughout Europe. We were looked at as a country that had gone rogue. And it was a reputation we deserved because, frankly, we had gone rogue. We listened to the Project for a New American Century that had said to us, the end of the Cold War, America needs to be decisive. We need to use force in a way that demonstrates that, number one, that we will be the hegemonic power for the next century, that we will avert the possibility of the emergence of a multipolar world, and we will use force so decisively that no one will, for now and in the future, threaten us again. And the experiment that was going to prove the Project for a New American Century was right was going to be the Iraq War. I served on a Council on Foreign Relations working group that met weekly after 9/11 to talk about where we go. Those guys, from Richard Perle to Newt Gingrich and others who were on our group, were arguing for Iraq a week after 9/11. We have to do it to show that we will stand tall against terrorism, even though there was no connection at that point between Saddam and terrorism. They were determined, they won the day, and the problem is that the outcome of this war actually proved to be exactly the opposite of what they had projected. Our military was not decisive. In fact, at the end of the day, our military became exhausted. Four or five tours of duty between Afghanistan and Iraq later. We have a suicide rate, people don't know this, suicide rate of American veterans, 22 a day. And it's been going on like this for years, which means every year we lose more veterans to suicide than we lost in the two wars combined. The American military is not willing to commit to another foreign adventure because simply they don't feel we have the capacity to do it with an all-volunteer army that is simply exhausted and incapable of being committed to another adventure. Number two, we unleashed a sectarian war in Iraq and beyond that has undone any plan we had for stability. You remember, the lie of the war was not that there were weapons of mass destruction. The lie of the war was really that we would be done in 6 months, that it would only take 60 to 90,000 troops. I always think about General Shinseki, you know. At the Pentagon, he said 355,000 troops, and he got fired from his job because he used a number that was not one that they'd agreed to. Poor guy then becomes head of VA and has to deal with the returning veterans because we had to use many more than they'd actually prepared for, and they're longer than they'd prepared for, and they didn't commit the resources to the VA, so he gets then nailed when he's at VA for not being able to take care of the veterans for the war that they, in their failed estimate of what it would take, ended up having to commit. It also ushered in a multipolar world because Iran became emboldened. I mean, the big victor of the Iraq War was Iran. The check that Iraq had placed on Iran that had created at least some kind of stability in that region, after an 8-year bloody war that the two had fought with each other that had weakened and literally devastated both countries, We then emboldened and empowered Iran to begin to exert its influence in the region, in Iraq first, and then now in Syria, and in Yemen, and in Bahrain, and in, with much greater force in Lebanon. And we weakened alliances throughout the region. Some countries went along with us because they frankly didn't feel that they had a choice, but at the end of the day, America lost credibility because of that war. Barack Obama inherited that mess. Also, I would add, with regard to the Arab-Israeli conflict, if you recall, while Bill Clinton used the line during the presidential convention, best deal ever, and Arafat turned it down, which simply wasn't true, because long after that, Palestinians and Israelis were still negotiating at Taba. And negotiations were only called off, they had come very close, but negotiations were only called off because Barack called them off because he was heading to elections in Israel in January, and he didn't want the negotiations going on during the elections. He lost the election and Sharon took over. And the Mitchell report, which deserves to be read even though people do not read it, George Mitchell, one of the most thoughtful statesmen I think our country has produced in a long time, wrote an excellent report that says that the myths about what started the Second Intifada were just that, that we needed to get back to the process that we had been that had been taking place before the Intifada, and he laid out the track, which ultimately got translated into a roadmap, but the roadmap was never followed through. Principally by the Bush administration, which neglected the peace process until his second term, and by then it was too late. And what happened during that period was, number one, the Palestinian Authority was destroyed. Number two, the right wing in Israel simply became more empowered by the failure of peace and by the continued acts of terror that had created such a backlash in the country, that you ended up with what I call two pathologies emerging, one on each side. On the Palestinian side, you had the pathology of basically kind of a self-destructive mindset, the pathology of the abused child. Nothing I do is right. It doesn't matter what I do. If I kill some people, if I act out badly, it doesn't matter. I'm just showing them that I can strike out. On the Israeli side, that was the pathology of the spoiled child. It doesn't matter what I do. I'm never going to get punished for it. And so I can expand settlements, I can behave in a self-destructive way with regard to what my real interests are to have peace, and it doesn't matter because no one's going to restrain me. People don't realize, when Oslo began, there were 170-something thousand settlers, and today there's almost 600,000 settlers. And in part, the period of neglect during that early Bush years, and I would say also during the Clinton years, because settlements were expanding during Oslo. They almost doubled by the end of the Clinton administration, and then they increased again by the same amount during the Bush administration. The result was that Israel became so entrenched in the territories that the concept of even having two states became difficult to imagine where you would put that Palestinian state to make it viable, to make it contiguous, to make it something that actually could survive. And because it was neglected for so long, Barack Obama inherited a mess, a real mess. Two failed wars, an exhausted military, an emboldened Iran, an Arab world that was frustrated and fed up with America. And he goes to Cairo. After a number of steps designed to create confidence, first he appoints George Mitchell. Then he goes and he makes a statement to Arab television about how I'm going to change, start a new direction. And then after a few more initial steps, he then goes off to Cairo to deliver a magnificent address on a new beginning for America in the Muslim world. If you haven't read the speech, I advise you to go back and read it. There's a number of documents like that. The Iraq Study Group report, everybody bought it, nobody read it. The Mitchell report, everybody waited for it to come out. When it came out, nobody read it. Obama's speech, everybody commented on it, but nobody took it seriously. I was on CNN the day it was being given, myself and Liz Cheney, who I think we're going to get in Congress soon. And we were there to watch the speech and then comment on it. It was fascinating. I mean, she had the talking points prepared. The talking points were, it was an apology speech. It embarrassed America. It set America back. It was this, it was that. And it was a total slam on what the president had tried to do. I actually did three shows that weekend, concluding with the Sunday morning CBS show. And I heard the same talking points from everybody. When I was asked, the final question I was asked was, can the president close the gap? Can he heal the divide? And I answered, with the Muslim world, I think he probably could, if he got a chance, but I'm not sure he could heal the divide with American conservatives who aren't going to give him a chance. And so literally every commitment or every promise of a commitment that the president made in that speech was undone by Congress, which attempted to even closing Guantanamo, they made difficult because they passed the not in my backyard legislation, which was going to prohibit any state from accepting these prisoners to end this illegal situation that was taking place, this legally ambiguous situation that was taking place in Guantanamo. But on all of the other issues as well. And so the president tried, but he got stymied. What was interesting was that in the middle of all of this, failed war in Iraq, failed war in Afghanistan, which the president initially wanted to get out of, but responding to the pressures from folks in the military and some folks in the government, ended up sort of cutting the middle and making a mistake, I think, putting a surge in place, which I remember having on my show some of the military folks who were in charge of that, talking about Helmand Province, we've taken it over and we're marching forward and we're whatever. And if you look in the paper now, we're still fighting in Helmand, we're losing ground in almost all these places. I mean, at the end of the day, there is no way on earth we can remake Afghanistan or direct traffic as to what the future of that country is going to be like. Similarly, in Iraq, the president wanted to get out. I remember saying in a conversation at the White House, the right wing was criticizing for setting a date. Actually, it wasn't the president who set the date. It was George Bush who set the date with the Status of Forces Agreement. The issue was never the date. The issue is what you did between now and the date. And frankly, I think we squandered the three-year window we had. And when the opportunity was there to push for an Alawi government that would have been inclusive, we ended up buckling to the pressure from Iran and others and put Maliki in charge, which was a sectarian government, which spawned many of the problems we're dealing with today. Here's my criticism of Barack Obama. Absolutely right intentions. But because he inherited not only this mess, but a hyper-partisan environment in Washington, and because he didn't do politics the way Bill Clinton did politics, or the way Lyndon Johnson did politics, or the way James Baker and George Herbert Walker Bush did politics, he got rolled. And he got rolled one too many times, and Iraq was one of the times he got rolled, and so at the end of the day, he just got out and didn't play Iraq politics or American politics, because what should have been done wasn't done. And so we left Iraq a mess, a disaster waiting to happen. We stayed in Afghanistan, which was a disaster that was continuing to happen. And on Israel-Palestine, he tried at the end of 2 years, when nothing was working, he gave a speech at the State Department saying he was going to finally do it before the end of his second term. And he gave this speech on the anniversary of the Cairo speech, where he said, speaking first about the Arab Spring, he said, we didn't start it, we can't direct it, and we can't determine its outcome. But what we can do is be helpful, to be helpful in creating conditions that make democracy work. And he talked about investment in creating a middle class, job creation programs, healthcare, education, et cetera. I turned to the person sitting next to me and I said, this is not a speech to the Arab world, this is a speech to Congress. He's telling Congress that if you want us to play a meaningful role in advancing democracy, you've got to come up with the funds to help create the building blocks of democracy in these countries. Of course, Congress would have none of it. But then he said there was a second thing we had to do, and that was make peace on the Israeli-Palestinian front. Now, why would he have said that? Well, the thinking that went behind that is that it is not the case that if you have Israeli-Palestinian peace, the Middle East is going to be It's not like what the neoconservatives were telling us about Iraq, that flowers would be in the street and Americans would be welcomed as liberators and a beacon would shine that would light democracy throughout the whole Middle East. That was part of the lie that was told. That's not the case. But what it would do is it would change the relationship of America with Arab countries in the region. By stabilizing and normalizing relations between Israel and Arab countries because you were working for peace between Israel and Palestinians, you would have a much different arena in which to operate. And so the president understood that. And so he said, we've got to work for peace on this front. And the way to do it is 67 borders with land swaps. Now, what was interesting to me was that what he said was exactly what Netanyahu had just a few weeks earlier been pushing him to say. He wanted the president to commit to Bush's commitment to Ariel Sharon. What Bush said to Ariel Sharon was, 49 armistice line with territorial exchanges. Now, the 49 armistice line is the 67 border. And territorial exchanges, to the best of my knowledge, means land swaps. But it wasn't Bush saying it, it was Obama saying it. No, so Netanyahu went to the White House 2 days later and famously pointed his finger and lectured the president, and then goes to AIPAC 3 days later and rejects it out of hand. And because the president was an actor in an election year, he backed off. 2 years later, the pathologies that we described, that I described, had simply intensified. It became increasingly more difficult to get the Palestinians to do anything. Their leadership had become so decayed, their politics had become so absolutely dysfunctional, and the Israelis had moved so far to the right that it was impossible to even conceive of how you would put a left-wing coalition or a moderate coalition together in that country. And so John Kerry tried as no one else could try, to create conditions that would bring people together. It simply wasn't going to work. And so here we are, 16 years, two administrations, Iraq going nowhere, Syria in, I think, very desperate circumstances. A multipolar world surely emerged having emerged in that region with Iran, the ascendant power, the Gulf, very threatened right now, and creating out of their threat their own problems in Yemen. Syria, a proxy war where everyone is playing in the playground and creating devastation for the poor people of Syria. Turkey carving out its territory, the Kurds looking to advance to carve out theirs, and the Russians sitting pretty, having picked a side that seems to be ascendant. And the Israeli-Palestinian arena going nowhere fast. What can the president do? What should be done? I actually think that in the 2 months between the election and the new administration, the president can actually do a couple things that would be very helpful for the next administration. The first would be, we still have the State Department guidance on settlements. They're illegal. We said it. Politically, we've stopped using the State Department legal opinion on settlements, and we've started using other language about unhelpful or whatever. But Congress has moved us in an entirely different direction, now wanting to pass legislation that talks about Israel and Israeli-controlled areas, trying to create new legitimacy for Israel's occupation in the territory, literally wanting to say that there's one state. Now, there are those who'd say, well, fine, let's just deal with one state, and it's an apartheid state, and we can let the world decide what to do with it. But if you really want a two-state solution, then you've got to say settlements are illegal. Not unhelpful, not illegitimate. New settlements illegitimate, but once they're built, they become new realities that we have to accept. But illegal, because they're built in territories occupied in time of war, and there's no justification for that. And if you do that, and if you allow a resolution to go through the United Nations that has teeth, then what you do is a couple things. One is, you, number one, create a debate in Israel, and you empower peace forces in Israel who will have the sense that America is not willing to just sit back and let Netanyahu roll them. You'll also empower the moderates in the West Bank and in Palestine, who have felt that no one has their back, and therefore they have no way of functioning in an organized and disciplined fashion. And thirdly, you will allow the world community to take some control over this situation by creating a system that will sanction bad behavior and establish rule of law and justice in Israel and Palestine. And finally, you will give America the leverage it needs to deal with Arab countries to make the tough calls and do the tough things that need to be done if there is to be American leadership in that region. American leadership isn't going to come from bombing Syria. American leadership is going to come from doing the right thing, and that would be one of the things to do. I frankly also think, and what I'd called for a couple of weeks ago, but apparently I was undone, I thought that Mosul was a mistake. I think that advancing on Mosul right now is a mistake. I frankly think that we're not ready for it, because you will not, you can retake Mosul and never defeat the Islamic State as a concept. You can take Raqqa and not defeat the Islamic State as a concept. In order for these two poisonous entities, or one poisonous entity, to be defeated, there has to be radical change in the governance in Iraq and radical change in the governance in Syria. Then you will be able to unite and defeat this problem. But as long as there's, if the popular mobilization units, if the Iran-led groups go into Mosul, or if the Kurds are in the lead in Mosul, and not a non-sectarian Iraqi army that represents a non-sectarian representative Iraqi government, you're not going to defeat the Islamic State. What you're going to do is create a humanitarian disaster of another million displaced people and sectarian violence in the city of Mosul, especially among the survivors who are left there. And the same, I fear, will happen in Raqqa. What we're seeing in Aleppo is only the beginning of what will continue to happen and unfold in Syria. And so I actually think that the United States has to, I would hope, be pushing that if we do, and now it appears we are going into Mosul, that we withdraw, we withhold air support for popular mobilization units, that we only support the official Iraqi army, that we not allow the Kurds, and now we have the Turks also making noise about wanting to, and actually it appears that they are coming in, which is only creating even a bigger problem in Syria, in Iraq. I just don't think we were ready. And in Syria, I've never supported using military force in these conflicts. I just don't think that they're helpful. And for those who say we have to save our honor and do it, that's a bad reason to want to use force anywhere. But at some point, a red line needs to be drawn with Russia, and a serious red line that we actually enforce. And the form that that enforcement takes, whether it's man pads to some vetted, very stringently vetted opposition forces, or some other form, I'm not a military person and can't tell you what the exact option should be. But frankly, I think that we've allowed Russia too much rope in Aleppo, and it is not a helpful situation, because they may be victorious, but in conquering the eastern side of the city, that's not going to make the Islamic State or Nusra, Jabhat Nusra, and its newly morphed creation go away. It will only reinforce the fact, as long as the Assad regime is held without accountability, there is not a possibility of ending the conflict in Syria. And so I think that some decisions need to be made in these last 2 months. I don't want to see this administration hand off the same mess 3 months from now that they've got on their hands right now. And I think they can take some steps to make it to make the situation for the next administration just a little bit better. It would save Hillary Clinton, for example, on the Israeli-Palestinian front from having to deal with settlements, because he would have already done it for her. And frankly, while she might say, that's not what I would have done, she would have a fait accompli created, and it would make her job of dealing with the Israelis a whole lot easier and dealing with the Palestinians a whole lot easier. I think I'll just end it there, and we'll take questions. Thank you.
if you don't mind.
So we will start with just a conversation maybe among the three of us, and then we'll open up to the questions that you've asked in the audience. Jim, I heard you kind of start by saying about the Bush administration involvement in the Middle East, the terms never had a clue, drift, blunders. You've used a lot of terms that are basically indicating they didn't know what they were doing. If you talk to people in the region, in fact, they would tell you the U.S. administration knew exactly what it was doing. Mm. The U.S. administration was out there in order to destroy the state system of the Middle East. And in fact, people are very convinced, and they quote Condoleezza Rice having said, we want to have creative chaos in this region. We've had too much focus on stability for 60 years, and it hasn't worked, and now let's have creative chaos.
I was there
chaos.
When she gave that speech.
Yeah. So how would you respond to people in the region?
Let me tell you, it was interesting because she gave the speech by saying, for the last 60 years, we've made a mistake in this region. People held their breath. They thought, oh my God, she's going to say we supported Israel against the Arabs. And then she said, we've supported kings and dictators against their people. And people were like, what? You know, number one, your only two allies that are left here are the king in Jordan and Hosni Mubarak. And you're in Egypt, for God's sake. What are you talking about? But, I did a book a couple years ago called Arab Voices, and it was about the myths that Americans have about Arabs. I went everywhere talking about the book and why we have these myths and how to understand the real nature of what the reality in the Arab world is. And invariably, I would get the question from people, okay, these are the myths that we have about them, but what are the myths they have about us? And I would immediately respond, they think we're smart. And they'd say, well, what do you mean? I'd say, well, no, they think that we do stupid stuff, but they can't admit that we're stupid. And so they take the consequences of that stupidity and say, you must have meant it because you are powerful and smart. And it's partly a function of the fact that the Arab world has a complex that is largely historically driven. They feel no control. They feel that they've lost control of their history since having been governed by the Ottomans and then betrayed by the Western powers and then Sykes-Picot, the region carved into little pieces and regimes that were imposed upon them that were sectarian, the French, the Alawite here, the Maronite there, the Jewish state here, the kings in Iraq and Jordan. And their feeling was, we don't control this. And so there must be a design to make all this make sense. And they construct these conspiracy theories to make sense out of the absurd, which some people do in different religions in the world, right? It's an effort to make sense out of chaos. I understand that. I see it all the time. But I argue back that it may be that the Iraq war unleashed Iran and made the Gulf states more vulnerable and threatened, and therefore they needed to get more weapons from the United States and was a boon for our weapons industry, etc. That may be how it worked out, but frankly, there was nobody smart enough to think that one through. It was a blunder, and it was a blunder that had those consequences to it. And it would almost make me happier if it were by design. Because if you're smart enough to do that by design, then maybe you could be smart enough to do something else by design. But I frankly, having seen these blunders, I remember the first time I thought about this was during Vietnam. You know, there was the same sense back then that we knew exactly what we were doing, you know? And then first Vietnam, and then Cambodia, and then Laos, and the dominoes fell in the opposite way, not the way we thought they would fall. And the result was people thought America must know what they're doing. They didn't. They really didn't. And they don't know now. And so our policy looks like it's meandering. It's meandering because it is meandering, because frankly, we don't have a clue. And look at the Obama administration dealing with Arab Spring. I don't fault them for not knowing what to do. Frankly, no one knew what to do. You know, it was a situation that was out of control. And it played out quite badly. But I don't fault them for it. It's that there are dynamics sometimes that superpowers can't control. They have to try to understand them and maybe help steer them. But when your credibility is so low and your ability to function in the region is so hampered by your own politics, then even when situations could be managed, you can't manage them because, frankly, nobody wants you there. And that's part of our problem right now. We're not trusted.
We have quite a few questions from the audience, and so maybe I will turn to, you know, the issue of the effort to create a two-state solution. And the one question from the audience says, it's obvious there will not in the near term be a two-state solution. Is it time for policy speakers, NGOs, to focus on equal rights for all of the inhabitants of Israel and Palestine? And you know, maybe that could, you've talked about some steps, and I know you had an article recently, you know, of reiterating the U.S. policy of the illegality. Is there anything else? For myself, having been working on Middle East issues in Brussels when George Mitchell was working on this, and to see over the year or two that he was there, that it wasn't going anywhere. Is there any political will in the United States to do this, or is the questioner who says, well, it's obvious this isn't going to happen, is that a more realistic outlook?
I think I framed my remarks as, if for those who want a two-state solution, this needs to be done. But because if you don't do it, then you've actually buried the prospect of it. I frankly think that it is buried. I don't see how you get from where we are to two states. And so I would agree with the questioner's initial assumption that, therefore, the focus should be on equal rights and on human rights and on injustice and on violations of rights and looking at everything from home demolitions and collective punishment and acts of humiliation that occur on a regular basis, or looking at what is happening. It's not just settlements being built, it's where they're being built and how they're being built, and the demolition and the destruction of Palestinian property, uprooting olive orchards, destroying vineyards, tearing down communities to make way for these settlements. If we apply the standard of human rights as we would want to apply them in other countries, if we apply it there, I think we'd be doing the right thing. There's no political will to do that either here in the United States, which is why I believe that ultimately the UN or somebody else has to be able to do it, because Congress just is incapable of allowing an administration to take effective measures. So for those we've now entered an era where everybody agrees with two states, but nobody's willing to do anything to get two states. And so, frankly, I just call them out on it. You want them? Then act like you want them and do something about it. And if you don't do something about it, then understand what you've done is you've laid the predicate for a single state that is an apartheid state, and the consequences will be felt for a couple of generations. I personally am not willing to be an advocate for that, because I'm not willing to say that I want to see the next two, three generations of Palestinians and Israelis live locked in this conflict with each other. I want it to end. And if separation is the way to make it end, then for God's sake, make it happen. But if for those who will not let it happen, and who say, well, we want two states, but of course he has to be able to build those settlements and we're not going to do anything about it. He has to be able to continue to do what he's doing and we're not going to do anything about it. Then understand that what you're doing is you're saying, we're not going to get it, we're not going to have it, and the one state is inevitable. It's your call, not my call.
Do you think then that a new president should take the familiar path of appointing an envoy, of making some kind of a push? Or do we really need to go to the drawing board if we are?
I think it's go to the drawing board, because a new envoy and a new push and a process for the sake of having a process, the old Kissinger, the illusion of progress to substitute for real progress, is not going to wash anymore. And the Palestinians have called them out on that. Just having a meeting may make somebody here in Washington happy, but the Israelis have done everything they could to so weaken the Palestinian leadership and so discredit the Palestinian leadership that while I am not a fan of the way Abu Mazen, the president of the Palestinian Authority, has operated, I understand that when the Israelis will give 1,000 prisoners to Hezbollah in a prisoner exchange, and give 1,000 to Hamas in a prisoner exchange, and won't give Abu Mazen the last couple dozen that were part of the deal that he'd made to continue the negotiations, then something is being said here about how they're weakening him and emboldening his opposition, who they say they hate and who they say they can't talk to. It's almost as if there's a design to strengthen Hamas and weaken the authority and discredit it in the eyes of its own people. And the tragedy is that Oslo, which was supposed to, I remember being in Dennis Ross's office with Aaron Miller when I was doing this work with Gore during the peace process, and they had just signed this the deal that created the A, B, and C areas, and they're looking at the map with all these little dots on it that were areas A, and Aaron was getting all excited saying, you see all of these, and someday we'll connect them all and it'll be, and I said, Aaron, what if they never get connected? No, because it's gonna, and I said, but what if it's a trap, like some Palestinians are saying, and they never get connected? That's what happened. We've got these little cantons in the West Bank that are separated, and there are roadblocks and checkpoints between them, and now they're separated by Jewish-only highways, and basically the design that the World Zionist Organization had laid out in the Drobel's plan back in the 70s is what's the reality, is that you've got settlements and highways that are so dividing the West Bank that contiguity has become an impossibility. And the difficulty here is that if Israel had to deal with a real near civil war to get 5,000 settlers out of Gaza, how are they going to get a couple hundred thousand out of the West Bank? Mm-hmm. How are they going to make that happen? And I don't think that they have the political will there to make it happen either. So I frankly think that we're in a very difficult situation and people just need to man up and deal with it. Mm-hmm. But they're not ready to, they still want to talk about two states in a peace process. I'd say, fine, if you want to talk about two states in a peace process, then behave as if you do and start laying down markers and being tough about it. If you're not, then what you're doing is you're saying, we're letting it go, and you know, 20 years from now, there's going to be 1 million-plus settlers in the West Bank and Gaza, and there's going to be 3 million, there'll be more Arabs than there are Jews, living in the borders between the Jordan and the Mediterranean. And the world will look at it and say, this is an apartheid state, and we're stuck with it. Mm-hmm. So the call is on leadership here and leadership in Israel. If they're not going to make the right call, then you get what you get.
I'll let Raghi ask.
So it used to be the conventional wisdom that a Palestinian-Israeli peace process is a prerequisite to everything else that's happening in the Middle East, and that if we improved U.S. relations with Middle Eastern nations, et cetera, and I'm drawing on a question from an audience member. But it seems to me that this issue has been a bit dwarfed lately by all the other conflagrations in the region. And now it's the focus of attention is on Iraq, on Syria, on ISIS, on Libya, on Yemen, and we hear a lot less about the Israeli Palestinians. So do you think this is still a conventional, it should be the conventional wisdom that it is a prerequisite, or is there, can we forget about this issue for a while?
Let me refer to my polling for a bit, because we poll on these issues, all of them. There's no question right now that Syria is front and center in everybody's mind. There's no question about it. In part because it's the headlines and everybody's dying. People are dying, and it's a disgrace and a tragedy. But Palestine remains I call it the wound in the heart that never healed. It is for Arabs what wounded knee was to Native Americans. And while some people will mistake what I mean when I say this and some will deliberately misconstrue what I mean when I say this, it is to Arabs what the Holocaust was to American Jews. I'm not making an equivalence here. That's how some, he equated Israel with the whatever. I'm not making an equivalence. I'm talking about the emotive content of it. In the same way that American Jews looked at it and said, these are people just like me. And look what's happening to them. It reminded them of their vulnerability. It reminded them of their loss of their lack of control over their own fate and destiny. It reminded them of the fact that they had been betrayed, and they had been so vulnerable that they were, that people like them could be subjected to that, and maybe it could happen elsewhere. Arabs, given their history and their loss of control, look at the Palestinians and say, that's, I had a friend, a Gulf minister, who hated Hamas and hated everything they stood for. And during the last conflict, called me one day crying, saying, I saw those kids, they could have been mine. They looked like my kids. What do? I feel so helpless. And that sense of being helpless, that sense of loss of control, of the betrayal of the West, of the vulnerability, of the loss of rights, of the inability to take any, they don't know what to do. And so if Palestine is quiet, then focus will be on Syria. But the next uprising, or the next violence that occurs, or the next Palestinians that start dying, it'll reemerge again, because there's an emotive content there that remains almost central to a definition in the Arab world of what it means to be an Arab. When we ask Arabs why Palestine's important to them, they say it's because it's Arabs just like me. It's people like me. It reminds me of my situation in some ways as well. And I think we ignore that at our peril. Yes, we've got to deal with Syria. And no, you know, those who say you solve Palestine and everything goes away, that never was true, and it's not true now. But if you ignore Palestine, nothing goes away. And the hurt remains there. You could have peace in Syria, peace in Iraq, peace in here, peace in there, and Palestinians would be in an uprising, and American credibility would still go plummeting through the floor. And interestingly enough, let me say that while Arab leaders want us to do more on Syria, when we just completed a poll, most Arab people do not want the U.S. to intervene militarily or even supply weapons to the opposition. Most Arab public opinion doesn't want that, because America screwed up one too many times, and they're just not trusted as to intervene in that way. It's something we don't understand here, but when we ask what do you most want America to do, humanitarian assistance, push for a diplomatic solution, end the killing, get Bashar out. When you say what do you least want America to do, it's bombing raids, it's intervene militarily, it's provide military equipment, etc. They just don't trust our judgment on that. So Arab leaders might, but Arab people don't. And I think that dichotomy needs to be understood.
I have a couple of questions here that I'm going to kind of combine that bring the question back to U.S. politics and different groups that influence politics. So, from AIPAC to this sort of proliferation of different policy groups that seek to influence U.S. policy on Middle East issues. Since the Arab American Institute is one of those groups, it would be interesting to hear a little bit about sort of the changing landscape that you see of how these groups seek to influence and how successful that is.
When we poll in American politics on these issues, we find not a, we used to call it a partisan split between Democrats and Republicans, but increasingly the partisan split has been shown to be a demographic split, with young people, educated women, and what are called minority groups, which when you add them up are like a third plus of the population, and so it's not so minority anymore, on one side of the ledger, and white, middle-class, middle-aged, born-again on the other side of the ledger. The 40% of the Republican constituency is born-again. what drives the debate right now is that demographic issue. We saw that in the Bernie Sanders campaign. Mm-hmm. We see it if you look at the WikiLeaks stories on Hillary Clinton stuff where her advisors say, don't talk about this issue, Israel, in public sessions. Our base doesn't want to hear about it. We see it play out in the emergence among young American Jews who are also millennials. In other words, we're talking about a millennial transformation here. Groups like J Street and J Street U and groups like Jewish Voice for Peace have been driving the agenda. They've been creating space for a discussion, for young Palestinians to participate in a discussion because they now have allies in the Jewish community that are supporting them in many of the same ways, sharing many of the same positions that they do. On the other side, on the Republican side, it's actually the religious right that is much more potent. Sure, there's a couple donors. There's the Sheldon Adelson and the Paul Singer or whoever these guys are who come up with $10, $100 million checks. But their impact is somewhat limited. I mean, poor Sheldon Adelson spent $100 million on Newt and didn't have a whole lot to show for it in 2012. It's the religious right that drives the agenda. And they're strong. AIPAC is important, and I can't dismiss their political influence, but they're not as powerful as we would like to see them, or as they would like to be understood. Part of it is a myth that, to some degree, we've helped create. I remember, you know, there's this notion that anybody they want to beat, they can beat, and anybody they want to save can be saved. Ask Rudy Boschwitz. Mm-hmm. I was there in Iowa working on a campaign when all the AIPAC operatives that were in the state like were rushed out to Minnesota to save Rudy Boschwitz. That was the marching orders of the day. Paul Wellstone ran all over them. And they tried to beat members of Congress that I was close to and supportive of for years. Couldn't do it. The ones that they did beat, they actually were able to make a lot out of it, but frankly, Chuck Percy, for example, in Illinois lost. That was actually Rudy Boschwitz used to use that. He used to use it in the Senate cloakroom. He'd say to senators who were waffling on something, he'd say, you don't want to have your fate be that of Chuck Percy. When Chuck Percy first lost in Illinois, it was about a month later, it was in December, he and I were at a conference in London. And somebody said, why did you lose, Senator? He pointed across the table and he said, it was his friend. Chuck and I were friends. I mean, he was sort of not being mean. He was just pointing, he said, it was his friend. They said, what do you mean? And he said, Jesse Jackson, here's the issue. In Illinois politics, Daley had been the king and would always pick who would run statewide races. And he would pick a downstater, usually a conservative, because that's the way he felt that they could win. Republicans would pick a moderate. And the black vote in Chicago went for the moderate against Daley. So they'd vote Republican in Chicago. Daley dies. After a couple of tumultuous elections, Harold Washington emerges as mayor. And Harold Washington taps Paul Simon to run. And the African-American vote, for the first time, turned out overwhelmingly for the Democrat. It wasn't the Jewish money. It wasn't the AIPAC support. Chuck Percy had more money than his opponent. What changed the vote in Illinois was the black vote went Democrat. What changed the vote for Paul Findlay in Illinois in the congressional race was Paul Findlay had more money than Dick Durbin. It wasn't Jewish money that won the race. That was a bigoted way of looking at it. What really won the race was that for years, Paul Findlay had been in a Republican district. He got redistricted in 1980. It became a Democratic district. He couldn't hold on to it. And so, but we allowed them to make that myth and play it up, and Paul Findlay wrote a book about it. I said to Paul when he was writing the book, I said, don't write the book. He said, why? He said, because you're creating the myth. You're going to make other members of Congress scared stiff to ever speak out and be truthful about this issue. But that's where we are. So I frankly think that the AIPAC certainly is strong. They've got a tremendous organizing capability. They produce thousands of people. They're able to organize maybe $4 or $5 million in PAC money and another $4 or $5 million in But overall, at the end of the day, as Bernie Sanders showed, the capacity of a citizen without that backing to make a difference is what ultimately rules the day. And the all of these progressive constituents from the progressive Jewish side, the Arab side, the millennials, the turned out for Bernie in a way that said to me, American politics demographically is changing. And I think that we're not there yet, but we're in the process of moving in that progressive direction. The point is to institutionalize that and make it real. And Middle East is a part of it, but there are many other issues that are central to that new coalition as well.
To stay on this politics side of things, I have a question here that says, what really happened at the DNC Platform Commission that prevented a platform resolution advocating for two states?
Well, actually, the platform resolution did call for two states. What they didn't want to do was add the word occupation and settlements. And it actually surprised me, because everybody that I was negotiating with on the Clinton side agreed. I mean, I know their positions personally. I know the work that they've done in their careers, either in Congress or in, Luis Gutierrez, right? Great member of Congress. He voted against the resolution to add the word settlement and occupation, and then about a week later sends out a letter on behalf of J Street saying how he opposes the occupation and settlements, and J Street is blah, 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 and send money to J Street. He and Keith Ellison signed a joint letter on that. But he wouldn't support the resolution because it was the politics, the power play of a campaign. The Clinton campaign was going to win, and they were determined to win on their terms. That's fine. But if you looked at the language that they finally agreed to, it was more progressive than any Democratic Party platform ever. The first time Democratic Party even mentioned the word Palestinians as having an independent state was in 2004, but they qualified it in so many ways that they might as well not have given them a state. It was conditional, it was demilitarized, it was the refugees would only go there, nowhere else. It was all this stuff that was in there. And it was subordinate to, they need a state so that Israel will be secure as a Jewish state. And that continued in 2008 and 2012. 2016, for the first time, talks about Palestinians have the right to dignity and independence and the right to govern themselves with freedom in their own land. I thought, wow, that was important. They were trying to preempt our opposition by giving us language that was the most progressive ever on that issue. Now, platforms do not create policy, but platforms indicate where they feel, where the party feels the mood is. They needed to be able to show that they get it. And so I frankly walked away from that saying, yeah, we lost occupation and we lost settlements, but we got language that they'd never been willing to give before, because they understood where the base of the party is, and they needed language to support that drift of the Democratic base. Similarly, there was language in the platform opposing BDS, and Bernie authorized us to try to strike it. Boycott, divestment, sanctions. So I introduced the plank to eliminate that language, and it put occupation and settlements in. Here's the argument they made. They said, read the platform carefully. It says, we oppose efforts to delegitimize Israel, including the boycott, divestment, sanctions movement. They said, we don't mean that we're opposed to boycott, divestment, sanctions. We're opposed to boycott, divestment, sanctions if it delegitimizes Israel. But if it moves in the direction of opposing settlements and all this stuff, well, that's okay with us. So my sense was that they were trying again to move the discussion away from a hard line. They wanted the Bernie people to support them is what they wanted. And so I'm never one to not pocket a win and walk away dejected. I walked away feeling we got something. We got better language than we'd ever gotten a platform. Look, I was in the 88 platform when I wanted to introduce the word Palestinian, and they told me, you can't put the P word in the platform. It'll kill us. And I said, but you say in there that you adhere to the Camp David Accords. Why don't you just say the Camp David Accords, comma, including the legitimate rights of the Palestinians, which was the language of Camp David. That was the language of Camp. They said, no, you can't put the P word in the platform. That was 88. Calling for dignity and independence and sovereignty and the right to govern themselves freely in their own land. There's a change in the discourse. It's late. It's not as far as I want it to go, but I'm not going to say that they didn't even begin to get it, because they did.
I have a question that takes us back out away from U.S. politics and the Israel-Palestinian issue. And it's a question about what you think about the relationship between Iran and the Arab Gulf countries, and whether or not there's any chance that that could evolve in a positive or peaceful way, or whether or not your polling looks at any of that. I don't know.
You know, one of the things that the Iraq Study Group called for was a regional security framework. That was very early on, but they understood that at the end of the day, there needs to be a framework in the Gulf region where Iran and the Gulf states and all the principals in Iraq, et cetera, need to be able to sit around a table and work. At the time, I remember they were said the argument was, you're asking for Iran to be at the table? And I said, yeah, because if they're not at the table, they're going to be playing dirty under the table. And as I said, the Iraq Study Group report, everybody, I remember during the 2006 election, everybody was running, what are you going to do about Iraq? They said, well, we're waiting for the Iraq Study Group report to come out. Every member of Congress, that was the line. The Iraq Study Group report came out, and then everybody wished it hadn't come out and ignored it. The Bush administration cherry-picked the parts of it they wanted, including a one-off meeting with Iran in Baghdad. A one-off meeting, and that was not to get Iran at the table one time. It was to sit with Iran and all the parties, as tough as it was going to be, just as tough as it was to sit with the Soviet Union in Eastern Europe and create the OSCE, a framework where, despite the fact that we hate each other's guts, we know that at the end of the day we need to sit and talk to each other to work out frameworks for stability and peace in the region. Every conflict that exists right now in that region has Iran on one side and Saudi Arabia on the other side. You can pick a side, and that only adds fuel to the fire, or you can try to create a framework where they actually sit down and work it out. That's tough. It's tough. But I frankly think that the Iran nuclear agreement was a mistake. I supported it. I supported the fact that there was a negotiated effort, an effort to resolve a conflict peacefully through negotiations. But it was a misdirection. Israel wanted to raise the issue of Iran's nuclear program. Stop Iran's nuclear bomb thing. And to me, the biggest threat that Iran poses is its meddlesome behavior in the region, its role in Iraq, and role in Syria. At the time, those were the principal ones. Now, if we had used the sanctions regime, if we had used the pressure of the P5 plus one to negotiate a framework for Iranian Gulf relations in that region, that would have been pressure well spent. But instead, we used all of that pressure, all of that diplomatic capital, to stop Iran from building a bomb that they didn't have, and ignored the behavior that they were participating. And they said, well, they'll get a bomb. I said, you know, number one, don't call me Donald Trump here saying what the hell if they have a bomb. But the point is, you know, we're the only ones who ever used a bomb. And frankly, you can't use a bomb. Because if you use a bomb, 5 minutes later, your country's a parking lot. It's like there's no first use, there's no second use, there's no use at all. And the biggest threat Iran poses is not to Israel, it's across the water. That's the threat they pose. And so we should have been sitting, the Saudis and the Gulf states combined, with Iran and finding a way to create a framework for peace and stability in that region and end each side's meddlesome behavior in the other countries in that area. But that's not what we did. What we ended up doing was focused on the bomb. I wrote an article afterwards. I said, okay, you did this, now let's pivot to, and let's do this, this, and this. But the pivoting never happened. We did the nuclear deal, and then we let it go. I thought the power of diplomacy, the power of sanctions to back diplomacy, should have been then used to create the regional security framework. And what I was told was the Saudis wouldn't agree.
I was just going to ask, would the Saudis agree?
Of course not. Of course they're not going to agree. But what is our leverage for? So what we did was we got suckered into supporting them in Yemen, which was a mistake for them and a mistake for us and a mistake for Yemen. And Iran sitting pretty, and who's winning? And so the issue is we have leverage, but we don't use the leverage to create stability. We use the leverage weakly to end up supporting allies when they do things that they shouldn't be doing. Israel on the one side, Arabs on the other side, and we end up with where we are today, with a Yemen that's out of control, a Syria that's out of control, a Iraq that's out of control. With Iran driving the agenda in Iraq and Russia driving the agenda in Syria. That's not smart diplomacy. We have much more power than we think we have with our allies, and as we showed in the Iran nuclear agreement, we have much more power with Iran. The economic sanctions were working. We should have then used Iran in that position and the P5 plus one pressure to get Iran to the table and then say to the Saudis, we got your back. We're your ally. You're going to come with us to the table, and we're going to work this out and create a framework for stability in the region. Everybody won't be happy, but it'll be a hell of a lot better than where we are right now.
So I have a question here about democracy promotion and what the U.S. role should be. The questioner says it's no secret that Middle Eastern democracies get away with a lot of actions, i.e. human rights violations, and I think the questioner means Israel, because that's the one Middle Eastern democracy that I can think of, that wouldn't be acceptable anywhere else. At the same time, we condemn similar actions by non-democracies in the Middle East. How do we promote democratic norms when the democracies in place are, for lack of better word, slimy and not considered very democratic?
Yeah, I go back to the second anniversary Cairo speech. When the president said, we can't create these democracies, I don't even believe that we are advocates or reasonably can be advocates for democracy, as much as we can be for human rights and justice. And then we can help create the building blocks of democracy. When we ask, we do polling in all these Arab countries, and we ask them a whole series of questions about a range of priority issues, asking them how important they are, and then we rank them. In every Arab country, the top priority is improving the economy and creating jobs. Second priority is either healthcare or education. Excuse me, and then goes down the line from there. Sound familiar? It's like what everybody else here in the world wants for themselves. We then ask the same issues and we say, what's the most important thing? Because we ask the Arab-Israeli conflict too. We put that in the mix. And so, in some countries, like in Jordan, and in Egypt, that's number two or three on the list. Because it's actually a domestic issue for them. And the Saudis it is too. We then ask the question, what can America most contribute? What of these issues can America make a contribution to? It's the economy, job creation, it's healthcare, and it's nowhere on the list of either their priorities or certainly not on the list of what America can do is democracy or promotion of freedoms or women's rights or any of that stuff. They will say in some countries, like in the UAE, women's rights are high. In Morocco and Tunisia, women's rights will be high. But nowhere do they want America involved in that. Just like, you know, if during the healthcare debate, imagine if during the healthcare debate, Sweden had come over and said, we know how to do this, let me talk to you about it. Or what if during the handgun debate, Canada had come across the border of Britain saying, we only kill about 80 people a year. You do 30-something thousand. Let us help you figure this out. We would have gone crazy. Nobody wants us to go to their country and talk about democracy. What they want from us is what we don't give them. And what we give them is what they don't want. Frankly, that would put any small business out of business. If that's how you were doing your job, right? I mean, we ought to be, it follows all the way through. It's like when I was doing this stuff during the with the Council on Foreign Relations on the public diplomacy adventure that they started, we were doing the polling in the Arab world trying to find out priorities and stuff. And I was doing TV shows at the time with two different Middle East networks and a third one also doing some work with them to NBC, which was part of Al Arabiya, and Abu Dhabi Television, which was at the time doing fairly well for itself. And the third one was, oh God, I can't remember. Anyway, so at various times, all of the networks would come to me, all of those three networks would come to me and say, we would like to buy the rights to, and they wanted American programming. They wanted National Geographic shows. They wanted CBS, some CBS news shows. They wanted whatever. And so because I had contacts here, I would get them the rights, and they would then go forward with them. And then we started Al Hurra. And I said, how dumb can you be? How dumb can you be? The number one, we in our polling, when we ask, what do you like about America? They like our TV shows. They like our educational system. They like our people. They like our products. They don't like our policies. That's what the driver of the negative attitudes is, the policy, not the values. They like our values, et cetera. If they like our TV shows, which is a product of our free enterprise system, why would we then create a really shoddy state-run television like Al Hurra and market that in the region? Shouldn't we give them what they want? I mean, why didn't we start joint partnerships between NBC and CBS and create these public-private ventures helping our networks help advise them on how to improve their program?
Well, somebody said in this Council on Foreign Relations thing, they said, well, but we're going to be able to give them translated versions of Meet the Press. I said, number one, who the hell wants to watch Meet the Press? And number two, what makes you think they don't already get it? Because guess what? Meet the Press is already available in the Middle East on the Arab networks with subtitles. So if you venture into an area either making a war or doing public diplomacy and you don't have a clue about the region, which Charlotte Beer didn't have, which Catherine Hughes, I mean, none of these guys did. They would call me. First time I went to see Charlotte Beers, she said to me, what should I do? And I said, listen, go over and listen. Find out what people want. I told Catherine Hughes, stand in the line at the U.S. Embassy, the visa line, and ask people, why do you want to come to America? What do you think about America? Find out what they're thinking before you try to... I mean, the first lesson you learn in small business is find out what the customer wants and then give him what he wants, or at least try to meet his need. We don't listen. We talk at people. We don't talk with them. And as a result of that, our entire public diplomacy venture has just been a total waste of money. Al Hurra is a boondoggle. I mean, we spend hundreds of millions of dollars on this thing every year, and nobody the hell watches it. What they're watching is American television on their own networks, which are the shows that they pick and they want. And or, they do these morning shows, and I've set them up with NBC to meet with the Today Show people for the send their anchors over to sit down and watch the Today Show in studio and talk with them and learn from them. We did it on our own. But if the government had tried to use our public diplomacy effectively to teach that stuff, we could have made a huge impact in the region. Instead, we created a product because somebody got the bright idea that we could create a television network and spend. I mean, we're the free enterprise system creating a state television, and what they want is our product that is a product of our free enterprise. I mean, how stupid is that? And it was all done by a conservative administration. So anyway, I mean, could we do democracy? Sure, but it's the building blocks of democracy. It's not talking about democracy. It's helping to create a middle class. It's helping to create and to promote a democratic culture. That's the stuff that you have to do subtly and smart, and unfortunately we're not subtle or smart sometimes. Sorry.
It's true.
Can I kind of get back to Syria? And we have a couple of questions on kind of what to do in Syria. I mean, clearly what's been happening over the last couple of months is Putin taking advantage of the paralysis resulting from the election to really gain advantage for Assad in Syria and possibly take over Aleppo. So, but you said the first thing that should happen after the election is that this administration should stand up to Russia and put the red line in the sand and kind of...
And do it.
Now, does that risk a military confrontation with Russia? So that's kind of one question that I have here. And then the second thing is, what next after doing that?
You know, at the end of the day, there's no solution to Syria that's not a negotiated solution. It's just from the beginning. I remember writing an article back like 3 months into the thing saying that the only outcome possible is a negotiated settlement that nobody will be happy with. That was Lebanon. We learned in Lebanon that there's no victor, no vanquished. At the end of the day, there has to be a compromise. Nobody will be happy. People who hate each other will have to sit around a table and negotiate a solution, but that's the only thing. But we got into this, Assad must go on the one side, and the terrorists must be beaten on the other side, and they're each of them fighting an existential conflict to the death. Unfortunately, they're going to take everybody with them. At the time, there were 3,000 dead, and I wrote in the article that if we don't get smart quick, there's going to be 30,000 and then later 300,000 until we realize that nobody's going to win this thing. And that's the problem. We're still at that point. Russia has now bought into the same argument. They were never going... Look, if I thought for a minute that if we'd given more weapons to the opposition early on, it would have stopped it, I'd say, fine, let's do it. But the point was that this was an ever-escalating conflict. Anybody that poured gasoline was going to be met with somebody else pouring gasoline because everybody had a stake in this thing. And they were going to continue to fuel it, hoping that they would win, with no adult in the room saying, stop, it's got to end. And the Arab League is at fault. They didn't act. They threw Syria out prematurely. The Gulf states are to blame. Iran is to blame. Russia is to blame. Russia felt they got screwed by Libya, and they weren't going to let it happen again. They weren't going to get dealt out of the region one more time. And so as long as you had sides, Iran and Saudi on one side, Iran and Russia on one side, and all of their allies, whether it's Afghani troops that are coming in to fight with Assad, or Iraqis, popular mobilization units that are not coming in, or the Hezbollah that's coming in, et cetera, that was going to happen as to the degree to which it accelerated. So the Saudis and Turks poured money in and weapons in, and then the Iranians poured more in, and then it kept going back and forth, and then finally the Russians got in. At any point, it was going to escalate. The point right now is that I think the Russians know that a negotiated solution is necessary, but they want as much leverage as they can before they get there. We've got to tell them it's time to stop, and damn it, if you don't stop, we're going to get in, and we're going to do it in the following way. And I don't have the exact thing, but will it risk a military? It may. But it also will, if we don't do anything, it will risk continuing this conflagration. I don't think Russians want World War III. I know we don't want World War III. I know everybody knows that there has to be a negotiated settlement, but somebody's got to take the decisive step to say, this is the line, cross it, and mean it, as opposed to the red line, and then it gets ignored. But I just can't see it continuing until February, because if it continues till February, a new administration is simply not going to be able to handle it, and it'll go another year before we get around to dealing with it. So that's it. I guess we're
well,
done.
Well, yeah,
stop.
Thank you. We could cover so many more areas. The questions were really great and very complex and well-informed, and thank you all for a great discussion. I'll let
If you need to write me, if you have a question that I didn't get to, it's jzogby@aaiusa.org, and jzogby@aaiusa.org, or all my stuff is on Twitter at jjz1600. All my polls are there. Or the other polling is all on Zogby Research, zogbyresearchservices.com. All of our polling is there. So
well,
thank you.
Before we thank Jim Zogby, let me also thank Mary Curtin and Raghi Assad for participating in tonight's event. I It was a real pleasure to have Jim Zogby here. I just wish he hadn't held back as he did. I've often told him he has to say what he thinks, but for some reason he decided not. So Jim, thank you so much.
There's some quote in here I remember seeing on. There it is. Humphrey tells it like it is.
Tells it like it is.
So Zogby does too.
So that's Trump.
So we want to.
I'm
thank
in company. You. Trump, Humphrey, and Zogby. What a ticket!
I feel like I've lost control of this event. So please join me in thanking Jim Zogby.
You had to throw in Trump, huh?